Hey everybody, welcome to Grace Family Church. In today's message, Pastor Stephen Christian talks about the difference between being dreamers and doers and what it looks like when we truly put our trust in a limitless God. Enjoy the message.
Okay, here, you want me to do this?
Right there, does it have to be right there?
Network?
Grace Family Church is real. We have found family here, but we found family and community at church.
The day we walked into Grace, they really embraced us as a family and made us feel part of the church.
It's not a place where we feel like it's just for the parents.
Grace is big enough that you can find whatever you're looking for.
From the Exchange to United to the Zone, Courageous, Beautiful, there is just a spot for us everywhere.
Whether you're going through a storm, whether you're going through joy, we get a chance to grow together and learn together.
We can all find a place to be loved on at church. We can all find a place to love on someone at church.
I don't know where we'd be without, you know, like our community.
We've become friends with people that feel like we've known them for our entire lives, and we're grateful for the community that we have at Grace Family Church.
Well, Grace Family Church, thank you so much for being here on this incredibly special weekend. My name is Pastor Stephen Christian, and I am so excited you are here. But before we go any further, I just want to say, give special shouts out to all the campuses. Temple Terrace, my friends at South Tampa, Land O'Lakes, Waters, Ybor, and everybody here at Van Dyke. Why don't we just give them a big round of applause? Yes. And everybody that's watching online, I know there are thousands and thousands of you, and I just want to say thank you for tuning in from around the world. And no matter where you're watching Grace Family from, this is your home, this is your community, and we love you very much. Let's give it up for them as well. Well, today I want to talk about dreamers and doers. And I love the exhilaration, the excitement that you get when you come up with a concept, you come up with a dream, and you put an action plan behind it, and then it comes to fruition. And I love those life successes, and I love those simple life wins. And I know that I love success and I love winning because as a young man, I was neither successful nor a winner at all. You know, I tried out for the football team, not just once, but several times in high school, and I never made the team. Being that I was about 100 pounds, the guys wouldn't try to run around me, they would more try to run through me. And so, relentlessly. And so, inevitably, every year, I would come to the football coach and hand back in my jersey and say, yeah, I'll try again next year. I couldn't make it in student government. I couldn't hack it in student government. I didn't know that many people. We moved around a lot. I wasn't that popular kid. I kind of kept to myself in high school. And so, I was never elected to student government. And I'm just going to be honest. I know my wife's watching. I'm so sorry, honey. I couldn't hack it with the ladies. I just couldn't. I had these things. I don't know if you've ever heard of them. They're called braces. And in case you've never heard of braces, here's what it is. It takes the sunlight and it reflects off these metal objects in your mouth and it blinds those of the opposite sex so they can't even see you. It's horrific. And the only thing that I could attract, if in case you've ever had braces and you know what I'm talking about, the only thing that I could attract was bits and pieces of random particles of food. And so, but I'm here to tell you, I am living testimony of the verse, Zechariah 4:10, when it says, do not despise the days of small beginnings. You see, we all have to start somewhere. The question that each one of us faces at some point in our lives is, what is that dream that God has for me? And once we find that desire, how do we take the next step? How do we put it into action? How do we complete the race that God has set out in front of us? You know, some here, they dream of becoming millionaires, while others want to be missionaries. Some want to write a worship song, while others want to write a New York Times bestseller. You know, there's a single dad out there somewhere, and he just dreams, he hopes that one day his children, they'll graduate high school. That would be success to them, to graduate college. While someone else, their dream, their desire is just to get a job. And there's other of us, they've already accomplished a dream. They've already accomplished a goal. They've been successful at something mammoth in their life. And they see that chapter slowly coming to an end. And now it's time for another God-sized dream. It's time for another God-centered dream. So where do we start on this journey of becoming a dreamer and a doer? Well, in middle school, I dreamt of becoming a musician. I wanted to be an entertainer. I was that kid jumping on my bed with a broomstick. That was me. I remember, you know, getting on the lawnmower and, you know, waiting till it started up so that I could sing at the top of my lungs and just start making up random lyrics. I remember one time in high school, I don't even know why, I got on my dresser and I pretended my bed was the crowd and I jumped and I crowd surfed and that was me. Well, after years of hard work and determination, my dreams actually became a reality. And so for those of you that don't know me, I was in a band called Amberlin. And we had the incredible opportunity to be able to tour the entire world over, it felt like. We went from Russia to China, Australia, Europe, all across America. We were on late night shows like Jay Leno and Jimmy Kimmel. We would tour with bands like Smashing Pumpkins and Linkin Park and My Chemical Romance. We had a number one song in America. We were on Universal Records and went on to sell over 1 million records. It was an incredible experience. It really was. But let me tell you, that is not at all where it began. Not at all. I mean, we all have to start somewhere. And so, I want to share with you a little insight, something my parents reminded me of, that before all of that, I thought I was going to be in hip hop. I was sure I was going to be a rap artist, man. I was so into it. And so my brother and I, we decided we were going to start a group called the CIA. And my parents uncovered our first music video. But before I show it to you, I just want to let you know that you're not going to be able to unsee this. So without further ado, thanks, Mom and Dad. This is my first music video I ever came out with. To the beat. For the best, don't just settle for less. Put your trust in Christ, you'll pass the test. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. You're a brand new creature with a brand new start. You'll have new life, one without strife. Filled with the love of Jesus Christ. Now if you think I'm boasting, you better relax. When I speak God's word, I'm speaking the fact. Oh my God. No. Wait. You didn't even clap for Amberlin, but you clap for that? Come on, priorities, people. I think my favorite part about that was the high fives with my little sister. And then I don't know why this didn't catch on with the kids. All right, don't despise the days of small beginnings. So the first step in this process is to dream big. Dream big. You see, God plants dreams and desires in each one of us. And they're not usually found in the lightning and the thunder. They're not usually found in the mighty winds that push us in one direction or pull us in the other. But I found it to be true in my own life. That's when it's when I stop, when I pause and I reflect. I hear that still small voice that just grows louder and louder and louder over time. What is it that keeps you up at night? If money wasn't an object and you knew you couldn't fail, what is it that you would pour yourself into? What is that fire in your belly that can't be quenched? What is that original idea that you believe that God's given you only? That's your idea, and it would make this world a better place. It would solve some type of problem. Well, I want to share with you a story about a man who had a fire in his belly that can't be quenched, couldn't be quenched. So grab your Bible apps, open up your Bibles to Nehemiah 1:3. And here we find a man named Nehemiah with small beginnings who was passionate about his dream to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And before we jump in, I want to give you a little bit of context before we read this verse together. So here it is. It is 586 BC. And the Babylonians have come in and completely just leveled Jerusalem. I'm talking the temple is gone, the fortresses are gone, the walls are completely just smashed. And the Babylonians enslaved the Israelites. And so now we fast forward in time to 530 BC. And here we find the Persians. And they came in under King Cyrus and they defeated the Babylonians. And in this process, the Persians said, okay, Israelites, you are more than welcome to go back to your homeland. You can head back to Israel. And so 50,000 of those Israelites headed back to Jerusalem. And here's the problem. Every time they tried to rebuild the temple or they tried to rebuild the wall, there was violent opposition around them. Kings, other kings that didn't want them to grow in power, outside enemies, they would just come, and every time they would try to build that temple, they would just get smashed. And so this is where we're picking up in Nehemiah 1:3. And here's what it says. They told me, the survivors who are left there in the province are in bad shape. Conditions are appalling. The walls in Jerusalem are still in rubble. The city gates are still in cinders. And when I heard this, I sat down and wept. I mourned for days, fasting and praying before the God of heaven. So Nehemiah at this point had a few options. He could have just sat down and cried. Oh man, I can't believe it. That stinks for my people. I wish somebody's got to do something. Or he could have said something like, well, God, you can't call me to this. You can't tell me to go do this. Man, I'm not an architect. I'm not a builder. I'm not a GC. Have you seen lumber prices? There's just so many excuses. And I think in our own life, we do that same thing. God tells us, hey, what about this? What about this dream? What about this desire? God, I'm not qualified. I do not have enough theology to lead a table at Courageous. I can't join a men's ministry. I can't do this. I'm uneducated. I don't have enough money. I don't have enough connections. But as followers of Jesus Christ, we are called to be more than conquerors. You are the head and not the tail. He does not give us the spirit of defeat or fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And Nehemiah knew it. In this moment, he was more than a conqueror. So go big. Dream big. Nehemiah wanted a wall so big it could keep the enemies out for 6 months at a time. He didn't ask God for a nice little white picket fence to surround the fortress or the land. He didn't ask for a few mall cops to stand at every corner. That's not what he was asking for. He was asking for mammoth walls. You see, we serve an unlimited God with unlimited resources, which means you get to dream unlimited dreams. And if you take nothing else away, I want you to hear this right here. If you can achieve the amount of success in your own abilities, in your own strength, your dreams are way too small. If you can achieve your goals in your wisdom, your knowledge, your power, those are myopic dreams. Those are not God-filled dreams. Because my Bible reads, when you're called according to God's purpose and plan, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Everything, all things. Let's not confine God by our lack of confidence. Do you hear me? Don't limit God by your limited thinking. I can't limit God by my limited thinking. We've got to dream big. And now it's time to be a doer, to become a doer, to take that first step. And remember where we started with Zechariah 4:10? I want to keep reading in that passage because here's what it says. It says, do not despise the days of small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand. See, the Lord rejoiced when a worker just picked up a simple tool and began the work. Do you know that God sings over you? He does. He sings over you. And when you gave your life over to Jesus Christ, angels were celebrating. They had a party in heaven for you. And when you take a step forward into the plans and the purpose that God has for you, he rejoices over you. And Nehemiah had to move forward. He had to take a step forward because dreams without action steps are just wishes. Dreams without any type of action is just a wish. So here's Nehemiah's plan. Here's his first step of action. He brought his dream and his desire before God. And by Nehemiah 1:7, here he is repenting. God, I am so sorry. God, forgive me. I have fallen short. My people have fallen short of the glory of God. Forgive us. And now by verse 11, he's already given God the glory. God, I honor you. And no matter what happens, you get all the honor. And so now we're going to take a look at Nehemiah 2:2 because this is the plan moving forward. At this time, Nehemiah is a very highly trusted servant in the royal court. And I understand that this probably doesn't mean much now, but back then, one of the most trusted positions in the royal court was the person that would taste the food and the drink for poison. And that's Nehemiah's job. So here he is standing next to the king, and here's what the king says in 2:2, Nehemiah 2:2. The king asked me, "Why does your face look so sad when you're not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of the heart, and I was very much afraid. But I said to the king, 'May the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when the city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire?' The king said to me, 'What is it you want?'" Let me stop right there real fast, because as children of God, you are going to be presented opportunities in this life. I guarantee it. Do you want to take this job? Do you want to buy this business? Do you, you know, your spouse asks you, do you want another child? No matter what it is in this world, you're going to be handed and given opportunities. But right here is a key insight into what to do next when presented opportunity. Right here, verse 4, "Then I prayed to the God of heaven." When you are given an opportunity, stop, pray. "And I answered the king, 'If it pleases the king and if your servant has found favor in my sight, let him send me to the city of Judea where my ancestors are buried so I can rebuild it.'" You see, the king did. He honored his request, said, "Hey, how long is it gonna take you?" But he gave him a passport across the country and gave him armed guards to get him there. And not just that, he gave him enough lumber to help complete the fortress, the temple, and the wall. This is proof right here. If God is for you, who can be against you? If God's for you, what can you not accomplish in this life? And I want to assure you in this. No, actually, I want to promise you this. If you take a step forward into the purpose that you are called to, there will be obstacles. There will be obstacles. As a band, we didn't just sign to a major label and start touring. It didn't work like that. We slept in our van night after night after night. We would end up in California on tour and we didn't make enough money on tour. We'd have to call our parents and ask for gas money to get home from California. I had to sell my car because I couldn't afford insurance. We were in Washington, D.C. one time, and we had no place to stay, and it was so cold in our van we couldn't sleep there. And someone said, "Well, you can stay in a house. I know a house you could stay in." And when we got there, we realized there was no heat, and this is dead of winter in Washington, D.C. And so we took what blankets we had, and we made a semicircle around the stove. I know this is so dumb. In hindsight, I see it. But we turned on the stove, and we opened the door, and we slept in a semicircle just to stay warm all night. I'm telling you, there will be obstacles. There will be challenges. James 1:2 says this, "Consider it pure joy when you face trials and tribulations." Not if. There's no if in that statement. Consider it pure joy when you face trials and tribulations. But don't stop at a what if. Imagine a what could be, because ultimately we know the I am. Don't stop at a what if. Imagine a what could be, because we know God. You know, part of a doer is racing strong. You've got to race hard. And I want to be vulnerable and honest with you for just a second. I can't stand NASCAR. Can't get into it. I'm sorry if there's a few of you that are out there that are fans. I know somebody at South Tampa is actually a race driver. I'm so sorry. I just can't do it personally. I can't. I don't understand how you could spend an entire day of your life watching someone go real fast and then turning left. And then real fast and then turning left. And guess what's next? Hey, hear me out. Go fast and then turn left. I can't do it. I'd rather just turn a ceiling fan on slow and just do this. Okay, I'm done. I just can't do it. I get it though. I do. I see it. I mean, listen, those race drivers are fearless. Those pit crews are so fast. And the engineering on those vehicles, I mean, they're trying to take off like 1 pound here just to make it 0.001. Okay, that's awesome. I can't do it. But I will tell you this. I love the competition in racing. I get it. There's a goal. There's a flag. There's a prize. There's something at the end. But unlike any type of racing sport at all, Christianity is you versus you. You're on your own track. In this life, it's you versus you. When you get to heaven, when this is all said and done, it's going to be you standing there before God, taking into consideration all your actions, all your deeds, everything you've said. It's going to be you versus you. Luke says it like this, "But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel and the grace of God." So many times God gives us a particular track, a particular course to run, and we stop and we start to look around at what others have or the track that they're on or what they've obtained or what they have. But God's asking you to run the course that's set out before you. Because see, we are the body of Christ. And if we truly believe that, our passions and desires, they're all gonna look different from each other. If we were all pastors, who would be the business leaders and the entrepreneurs that could fund us? And if we were all business leaders, who would be the missionaries? And if we were all missionaries in Haiti, thank you for being here. If we were all missionaries in Haiti, who would lead us in worship here tonight or today? We need each other. We are the body of Christ. And perhaps you feel like you weren't even given a fighting chance. So your racetrack doesn't look like a straight go left. Yours looks more like a figure eight demolition derby. You say, you don't understand my past. You don't understand the trauma. You don't understand my childhood. You don't see how little I make. But see, time and time again, I have seen God take the foolish things to confound the wise, the weak to overtake the strong. I know of an 80-year-old stutterer who said, "Don't send me, God," and God sent him anyway. And he stood before a Pharaoh and performed miracle after miracle, and his people were set free. I've read about a shepherd boy who grew up to take on a giant and become a king. I know of a boy who grew up to teach love and mercy and took on a cross and saved the world. Run strong, because see, God has a reason and a purpose for the circumstances that you are in today. A lowly servant named Nehemiah, he dreamt big. He did what God set him out to do. At the end of the day, Nehemiah ended up building a wall that was 2.1 miles around, 40 feet high, 8 feet thick. What is your wall? What is your dream? What is it that you want to accomplish in this life? See, being a Christ-centered dreamer and a Christ-centered doer, it's someone who ultimately runs a good race and doesn't give up the eternal for the temporary. We should never give up the eternal for the temporary. My wife and I were in New York City. It was like the first year that we were ever married. And it was like something out of a movie. We had just played a sold-out show in a ballroom in New York City. It was incredible. The crowd was sold out. They were in a frenzy. It was so much fun. And we had just signed to a record label. And so they rented out the entire top floor of this venue. And it was incredible. I mean, there was like, you know, the other bands were there. Our managers were there. The lawyers, the radio hosts, the publicist, all these people. We were having the time of our life. And right before the night ended, I locked eyes with somebody that ran the record label. And he began to walk over to me. "Hey, thank you so much for being on our record label. We're so excited about your project. We really want to push this record hard. We're just all enamored with you guys and with the band." And he said, "Now, there are two things that we can do to push this record, to make it the best that it can possibly be. And you can pick either one. We'll publicize it around the world. You just let us know." He said, the first one, you can get arrested. If you get arrested, we can make sure everybody knows about it. You'll sell so many records. Or, and he kind of glances over at my wife, he said, you can date a celebrity. The choice is yours. You let me know. Get back to me. And he walked away. And Julia, my beautiful new bride, the look on her face was how we both felt inside. We were just so lost. I could not believe it. But even in that moment, even there in that second, we knew there was no way we were going to give up the eternal for the temporary. And in this life, I pray that each one of you succeed at whatever you put your hand to, whatever business, whatever opportunity. In the name of Jesus, I pray just success for you and life and winning. I want it all for you. But even more important than that, I pray for eternal success for you. Because the Bible says, what is it gain if you have the whole world, but you lose your soul? What if you gained the whole world, but you lost your soul? This life can't be about money. It just can't. There's no way. No one on their deathbed's looking for their portfolio. Let me see that one last time. I could go to a graveyard tonight, wave around a $10 million check, and no one's coming to get it. It can't be about money. Is it about power? Because I've seen presidents and CEOs of corporations fall. I've seen people in government get voted out of the office. It can't be about power. Is it about fame or notoriety? You want to get successful on social media? I'm here to tell you firsthand that fame and notoriety is fleeting. You're here one day and you're gone, just gone the next. Nehemiah knew that he had to put God at the center of his dream. And before Nehemiah constructed that wall, Nehemiah built the temple. Who's at the center of your dream? What if you gained this whole world, but you lost your soul? You know, right now I'm going to ask you to do something a little different. I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes no matter where you're sitting, no matter where you are. You know, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart, that's it. That's all you have to do to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You don't have to give a sum of money. You don't have to pray so many times a day. You don't have to punch in some type of religious time card. God's not some kind of cosmic scorekeeper. He doesn't want what you have. He just wants you. And so if that's you tonight and you want to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I'm going to say a very simple prayer and you can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, I want to know you. I confess with my mouth. I believe in my heart that you died and you rose again. I ask you into my life. Forgive me of my sins. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. Darkness, my God. that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
That's who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop, never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that this message is a blessing to you and your family. And if you live anywhere in the Tampa Bay area and you don't already have a church home, we would love it if you would visit one of our many weekend services. Just go to gfcflorida.com to find the service time and location that works best for you and your family. Until then, God bless you. See you next time.